This video is on 7 advanced context engineering methods for AI agents. I spent 40 plus hours studying the best in the industry and extracted 7 methods that are intuitive and simple but advanced and suitable for AI agent in production. Also, we'll tie everything together with 8 method laws and will give you actually Python code in LangGraph. You can find all of the references in the description. I'm Mariam, PhD with 20 plus years in AI teaching AI agents to thousands in 90 plus countries. Let's go to method 1, pre-raw threshold. To explain the route, we can ask ourselves, what will you engineer context in the first place? We know that agents need useful context to create desired output. The context window is nowadays very large, like 1 million token. But after using only 10% of it, basically agents start to become poisoned, distracted, confused, or clashed. So context capacity is not the same as context quality. So how about that 10%? Company Chroma is going to explain that 10% to us. It says that model fails not cleanly at their limits, but it degrades progressively. It means that at 128K, they are in the safe zone. At 200K, they have like quality degradation. 500K, severe performance drops. And 1 million K is technically the drop or the limit. So what are the symptoms are that repetition, you start to get a slow response, you get some wrong tools, they call like invalid functions, they lost the instruction, they forget what you have just said. And what you can do is to avoid actually that rot. What are the solution to that is it's basically very simple. You monitor your context window and the context size continuously. As soon as you hit that 128K to 200K, you trigger reduction. Okay, you can say reduction, should I summarize it? It's not just the same. I will explain that in just a few minutes, but let's first identify another problem. Imagine you just detect the rot zone at 200K and you're gonna take care of it. But your agent still has like 20 more steps to execute and just need those information. So here is the critical question. If it cannot stay in the context, where does it go? Andre Karpathy says, treat your context window as a computer. Same as that CPU has fast access, RAM has like a little bit of a slower access, and then you've got disk, which is the slowest access. Your agents needs also that kind of hierarchy. So keep only what you need right now for the current decision, everything else offloaded. So our method 2 is basically context offloading. So you can do context offloading by storing everything heavy in files, like logs, search results, like scraped HTML, a PDF extraction, large JSON responses, and then return only the file path identifiers and clean summaries structured schemas. And you will have like 2 levels of context offloading. Level 1 is a short-term kind of Scratchpad. You write to Scratchpad and you read it from it, and read the Scratchpad. If it's empty, write initial bones. Otherwise, we just write the key findings to Scratchpad. Don't keep raw search results in the context. You just keep references to notes, and final answers are basically synthesis of Scratchpad notes. And if I want to show you the code, this is actually how simple we can just do it in LangChain. So use the Scratchpad like a message state, explain it, then write the tool. As you can see, you can just define the tools, write your Scratchpad tool, and then just save it. You just give the description, and then read would be again also same way, and then we have search tools or other tools, and then you can add that tool. So read from Scratchpad and write from Scratchpad to your tools. It is as simple as that. And the second one is just to long-term memory store, which is just write it to a Postgres. It's really easy. And if you look at the code, you can go ahead and pick up the vector stores, the PG to Postgres embedding, and just write it from a document to that Postgres. It is pretty straight. And there is these brilliant things that Manus does. They use kind of plan to do MD. And for every complex task, they just continuously rewrite that to do. And then in this case, memory lives in your system and not in your LLM or AI agent context. So you may ask, what about tools themselves? Don't 100 tools definition bloat context? Okay, just give it fewer tools. But then we cannot solve a like complicated problem. So we have this tool paradox. You know, you need more capability, but too many tools cause confusion, which is our method tree. Just before that, I have made one of my paid course modules free. It's a link in the description, and I will give you also a free guide. It's the first link. And if you want to dive into my paid course, it's also in the description. This is the 5-in-1 AI agent mastery. Okay, what are the three simple layers? So the core functions are layer one. Think of read file, write file, search browsers. So here is the trick. By just using these tools, you can do anything. For other things that you need, you go to pre-installed tools. Those are basically all your other tools. So if you've got a video converter or an image processor or speech recognition or even your MCP tools, you just install here unlimited tools, but they are just not in your list of tools, in your permanent tools. And finally, we have the layer of power, just write code. So you just write custom code for anything you want. So your agent will call any API, use any Python library, do heavy computation, process large databases at this stage. It just gives you that a small interface, but infinite possibility. But now you have another problem. Even with a smart tool design, tool outputs still add thousands of tokens to your context. So, for example, a single web search, it can be like 3,000 tokens, and then you have FireEat, another 5,000. And then after 22 calls, you are basically drowning in output. So how do you actually reduce this without losing critical information? It is with compaction. Do you remember that I was talking about compaction and reduction earlier, and I said I will talk about it later? This is actually our method four, which we'll show you how to compact our context. So we, instead of having that full raw context, we want actually that reference context, the compact context. So what we do in the compaction, and that's why it's reversible, you strip the reconstructable information but keep identifiers. So universal identifiers are file operation gives file path, browser operation gives URL, and search operation gives query strings, and API calls will give you request IDs. Context summarization is different. You compress information in shorter form, so your details are lost. And what is the golden rule for when to do summarization is that when you do summarize, always summarize from a full version. Never compact version, just always from a structured schema, not free format prompts. So let me show you do compaction, 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 and a little bit of summarization, and then you go compaction and compaction. And the last one you can see is just kind of hanging there, because a pro tip is keep the last few tools unsummarized, and this maintain actually the style of what you were writing. So it provides fresh view shot example. It also prevents the model from imitating your compact format. So coding it in LangChain is straightforward. What you can see is that you give the guidelines the same as I explained in the prompt. Add that note to the graph, which is a tool note with summarization. It's as simple as that. If you have a workflow that needs 50 tool calls, this is still going to bloat your context, right? That's where the method number five is coming. Another intuitive but very effective way to decrease your context window. So if you have a deep search, your agent is going to just do some research, get some links, then extract the key points, compare the resources, synthesize findings, and then you've got a lot of tokens at hand. And you do that five times and you're 140,000 tokens, which is you are in the rot zone. But if you want to use the agent as tool, which is called SOP agent as well, what you do is you use a helper agent. So each time you just create a new helper, fresh empty content, do the 50 tool calls you need, return the summary, and throw away the entire helper agent. Basically, you create another new helper the next time you need actually that tool. And in this way, the sub agent will return 500 tokens. So sub agent context is thrown away because it's basically temporary workspace. So if you're wondering, what if Hopper agent needs 200 tokens? Then I would say use this decision tree. Between 5 to 20 tools, just use your main agent. 20 to 50 tools, use a sub agent. And if you have more than that, basically do context offloading, as we have said, because it's just too much to do. And the question is, if sub-agents are so powerful, why not use them for everything? But we have a problem with these sub-agents because they have a trap, which is called isolation. Because in isolation, you increase the capacity, but then you lose coordination and cooperation. Cognition AI says, don't build a multi-agent when you need actually this coherence. You need to create a decision altogether. So what they say is, if you have this kind of tasks, that the agent breaks down to tasks and you get it and combine it, is almost surely unreliable. It's still unreliable when you do the sub-agents and they do the sub-task and they combine it. What is working is when you have supervision, one agent just kind of give two sub-agents the sub-tasks and they can just do it separately. I will give it back to the agent and that agent will combine it. This is what we call context quarantine. In context quarantine, you just have a supervisor agent. You synthesize everything. One agent does all the decision making. So when to use it, use multi-agent for information gathering. I use this supervisor system when you need coherence. How do you code it? Graph for both of them. So you have the math expert and the research expert, and it will be combined by the supervisor. But if any agent, main or helper, see different tools at once, it struggles to pick the right one. And we can solve that actually with our method number 7, which is RAG for tools. It's extremely intuitive and simple, but we are going to use our vector database, our RAG method, to solve this problem. If you don't know about RAG, I have a video about RAG on my channel. You just pre-process. You just create a registry of your tools. For each tool, you write a description, convert the description to embedding, and then store it in a searchable database. Then your user can ask something like, what's the weather in Tokyo? And then you go ahead and basically find all of the tools by finding the similarities in your embedding. The similarity gives you actually 5 top tools, for example. And in this case, it would get weather, get forecasts, get temperature, get humidity, and weather alerts. Now, agent basically can see only 5 tools. It will be way easier to get the right tools. It will not be confused by 100 other tools, which makes it very easy for your agent to choose. If we want to code it, you will have just tool registry, and you will have tool IDs and the description. As I said, you can just use the store base and spaces store in LangGraph, and you finally can have something like query that and will search for that tool for the top 5. This works actually with layer, action space, sub agents, or also agent as tools. All of the previous methods that we mentioned. It's relevant when you have a lot of similar tools. If you just have limited tools, it doesn't make sense to use RAG. I promised a number of laws and meta laws. Number 1, offload everything token heavy. Number 2, compact first, summarize last. Number 3, set alerts on 128K. Split by task type, not job title. 3 layer design, as I just mentioned. You go to basic utility and code, and then structure beats free format, you know that. And simpler systems always win. And at the end, the law number 8 is monitor continuously. And if you want to have also as a checklist, this is actually the context engineering checklist that you can also screenshot and always use. If you want to keep just one law, that would be like the unifying principle. That would be the simpler system always win, because context engineering should make the AI agent job simpler, not harder. So I hope that all of these methods could just make the desired output that you want for your AI agent. It makes it for my 300 plus agents that I have built. Check out my free module and also the course. All the methods that I mentioned are brilliant, but simple. You can only get better at them and apply them if you build AI agents. And if you want to build AI agents like hands-on and real-world AI agents, watch this next video where I build AI cybersecurity end-to-end in just 12 minutes. See you there.